think now would be. So we're going to be recording today's meeting so other people can see this later. But my name is Natalie Fritz, and I'm the archivist and director of collections outreach and social media for the Clark County Historical Society in Springfield. And on behalf of the Society of Ohio Archivists Advocacy and Outreach Committee, I want to thank you guys all for coming. This is something new that we're trying as a committee find a new way to spotlight the new poster that we're doing for the year. This is something that's been going on for decades now, that during Archives Month in October, Ohio has its own poster, and we get to amongst the committee, we decide what the theme is going to be, and Ken can tell you a little bit more about the rest of the process there. But we thought that this would be a fun new way to reveal the poster for the year, get you guys excited to get it in the mail and hang it up wherever you are, so we can share it with people. And we have some fun trivia thrown in between to talk about some of the top 10 images that were voted on by members of SOA. So thank you all for coming. And I'm going to turn it over to Ken.
Thanks, Natalie. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Ken Grossi. I'm the college archivist at Oberlin. And it's my privilege to talk a little bit about the 10 winners, top 10 winners, but remind you that, you know, we had about 60 images submitted for the contest from 23 different archival institutions across the state. They were voted on online, and we're going to list the top 10. And then the final selection was done by the designer for the poster. So the images from the top 10, first of all, from Logan County Historical Society, the photograph showing a new incubator helping one of the patients at the Mary Rutan Hospital in Belle Fountain in 1952. From the Winkler Center at the University of Cincinnati, Henry Winkler Center, showing the University of Cincinnati Surgical Amphitheater, which opened in 1915 and is still used as a lecture hall today. Again, from the Winkler Center, Albert Sabin administering his new oral polio vaccine to Cincinnati area children in 1961. From Cincinnati Children's, a reunion of the children who had open heart surgery at Cincinnati Children's in 1959. Again, from Cincinnati Children's, the first Sabin Sunday, April 24th, 1960, with thousands of families coming to Cincinnati Children for the free Sabin vaccine. Again, from Cincinnati Children's, Marilyn Hughes Gadsden, MD, founder of the Cincinnati Children's Comprehensive Sickle Cell Center in 1986. From the Bexley Public Library, the tribute to doctors and nurses done outside the Wexner Center at OSU in the response to the COVID pandemic. From Clark County Historical Society, Dr. Thomas W. Barton image in 1892, he became the first African-American doctor in Springfield, Ohio. From the Franciscan Sisters of the Poor Congregational Archives, Franciscan Sister Patricia Holly reads to children at St. Elizabeth Hospital in Dayton in the 1960s. And finally, from the Columbus Metropolitan Library, a Columbus student is shown receiving a vaccination shot for rubella using a jet injection gun in May 1970. And so I'd like to introduce the individuals who will be, or to tell you the individuals who are here today to talk about their entries, again, from the top 10. Dr. Mike Farrell and Laura Wirtz are here from Cincinnati Children's Hospital. Jennifer Girth from the Congregational Archives of the Franciscan Sisters of the Poor. David Dieselhorst from the Bexley Public Library. Nicole Sutton from the Columbus Metropolitan Library, and Natalie Fritz from the Clark County Historical Society. Do we have a representative from Logan Historical Society here yet? No. Okay, I'll turn it over to Natalie to introduce the first presentation.
Okay. And Betsy, I think we can go forward. Just real quick, wanted a quick note. Archives Month starts in October. And just so if you guys want to get put it on your calendar to prepare, Ask an Archivist is on October 13th, if you guys want to participate in that. So I want to introduce Dr. Mike Farrell. If you want to talk about, you'll have two slides coming up that you can talk about.
Well, thank you. If you don't know the backstory, this picture just looks like a bunch of kids maybe in a science fair of some type. All those children are survivors of open heart surgery. All would have been dead or severely handicapped if it had not been for that machine behind them. In 1949, we began working on the heart-lung machine, and it became operational in 1952. It was first used on a fireman at the General Hospital, and then the first open-heart surgery on a child was done here in 1952. And the bottom line is that machine led to all the open heart and other cardiac procedures that are being done today. Marilyn Gadsden was a pediatrician in Cincinnati area. She was quite interested in sickle cell disease. She founded the Sickle Cell Center at Children's Hospital and the center in Cincinnati. She, as you can tell from the picture, she left Cincinnati and went to the Public Health Service. But there she led a pivotal trial. Prior to this, there was no way to diagnose sickle cell in infants until they became symptomatic. And often the first symptom was an overwhelming infection. She conducted a multi-center, multinational trial of detecting sickle cell in the newborn and starting penicillin prophylaxis to prevent these life-threatening infections. There was a dramatic difference in the kids who got penicillin and those who didn't in terms of complications. And that led to the almost universal screening of all newborns now, not just for sickle cell, but all the hemoglobinopathies.
Dr. Farrell, I don't think we have a slide for the other picture that Ken had mentioned, but there was the Save in Sunday that I think was also a part of the top 10. If you could explain, I know we don't have the image, which Janet has put in the chat a link to all of the images, but if you could mention what the Save in Sunday was.
It's a picture, the front door of the Research Foundation, but there's a line of people, adults with their children, streaming around the block to receive the polio vaccine, which Dr. Sabin insisted be given out and be given out without charge. If you're under 60, you probably don't know the fear that polio struck in the hearts of parents back in the 50s and 60s. Kids weren't allowed to go swimming. They weren't allowed to play with their friends. It was a horrific disease. The vaccine was very successful in eradicating polio and was actually a contributor to its being eradicated worldwide. So it's one of our iconic pictures that we display everywhere.
And this was the photograph again from the Logan County Historical Society. And I don't think we have anyone here to talk about that this afternoon.
Well, Ken, I just wanted to say something really quick about the how we fell upon this theme for the poster this year. I know that the last several years have been what they've been like for everybody. And I know that last year there was some discussion of, you know, what should the 2021 theme be? And we talked about, you know, maybe do we look at pandemic history? I know people probably have a lot of that in their archives. And then when we discussed it again this year, we kind of talked about, well, maybe not focus so much on pandemics, but just in healthcare, because it's such in the forefront of people's minds, all of the like great developments and things that people in Ohio have done and just what they've seen in the last 2 years as far as stuff that we'll have in our archives years from now that people have saved from what we're living through right now. So I think that to hear stories like Dr. Farrell's, you know, about what polio was like to live through that and to finally have a vaccine for that. You know, we're kind of seeing, we have different eras of things like this happening. So we thought that that would be a very topical, but not right completely on brand, you know, not looking right at the topic of what's happening right now, but that to help us look back at all of healthcare advances and terrible pandemics and things like that we've been through and kind of highlighting both of them. So I think Betsy, the next slide, we get into our trivia, which you guys can write this down if you like. We're going to go over the questions at the answers at the end so you guys can see if you got them right. But we wanted to highlight some of the other images that were submitted using these questions that we're asking. So our first question here is, during which war was this image taken? A, the American Revolution, B, the Civil War, C, World War I, or D, the Persian Gulf? And this image comes to us from the Sandusky Library Archives. Our next question is, America had three waves of the cholera pandemic, but does anyone know in what country the cholera pandemic started? Our options are A, Canada, B, Brazil, C, America, or D, India. And the image here also comes from the Sandusky Library Archives Research Center. It's a cover of a pamphlet describing presumed cases and treatments for cholera. And I'm sure that everybody's got, if you're evidence in their local archives of the different epidemics that may have hit their area and effects that you would have seen there. So go to the next slide.
So again, this was the image of the surgical amphitheater at provided by the Henry R. Winkler Center at the University of Cincinnati. I don't think we have anyone here this afternoon to talk about that, but we are encouraged to check out their website, I believe they're going to have a blog about their entry. So please do so, check out their website. Next person to present is Jennifer Girth of the Congregational Archives of the Franciscan Sisters of the Poor.
Okay, hello. This image is of one of our sisters, Sister Pat Holly, Franciscan Sister of the Poor at St. Elizabeth Hospital in Dayton, Ohio, and it's from sometime in the 1960s. Sister Pat was from a large family, and she was the oldest of eight children and did quite a lot to take care of her siblings. She was also born with congenital hip dysplasia and underwent many operations as a young child and walked with a noticeable limp for the rest of her life. She was very open about her struggles with her leg and with her gait, and that sort of created a bond with children. And based on her previous operations and time spent in hospitals as a child, she was very much drawn to pediatric nursing. So this image, she is reading to a few of the children who were in the pediatrics ward at St. Elizabeth. And later on, Sister Pat became a professor of nursing. And I believe she taught at Raymond Walters, Raymond Walters was one of the two-year or community colleges affiliated with the University of Cincinnati. And I believe she may have also taught some at Miami University, but she taught nursing students about pediatric care and also about addressing the entire child, their emotions, their spiritual needs, and their physical needs. So this photo is something that I think some people, if they hear about the sisters, the congregation, they would remember that the sisters operated hospitals. And they operated about half a dozen hospitals in Ohio. At one point, they had over two dozen hospitals across the entire United States. But with the changing healthcare environment, they divested of their hospitals about 25 years ago. So most of the sisters no longer work as nurses, but from the beginning of the congregation's history, they have addressed healing of all types, whether that be the actual physical healing, such as in hospitals. They work as social workers. They work as parish ministers. And they also are involved in ministry that empowers women and children and supports working families throughout the entire world. This image is an example of one of our earlier ministries with helping children. And so I really like this image because it's a reminder to us that healthcare isn't just about curing disease, it's supporting the entire person, body, mind, and soul. So, yes. And also, Sister Pat did die very suddenly in 1997. She was about 60 years old. She fell and broke her hip and developed some devastating complications after that and died within a couple of days. So, you know, unfortunately, that lifelong disability, it was with her until the end. So that's our story.
Well, thank you, Jennifer, for sharing the story with us. I wanted to note that there is a link to the blog posts from Cincinnati, from the Winkler collection, that since they couldn't be here today, so you can read a little bit more about the pictures that that they had submitted that were in there as well. Go to the next slide. We've got another trivia question for you. The U.S. licensed the polio vaccine for widespread use in what year? A, 1963, B, 1955, C, 1951, or D, 1961? And the picture here is an undated picture from Clark County Historical Society's collection of a vaccine clinic I won't tell you when to give away the answer, but it is undated, so we have an idea. And the next question, here's one. This photo was taken in 1949. What disease do you think doctors are treating this child for? Is it A, rickets, B, polio, C, mumps, or D, chicken pox? And this image comes from the University of Akron's archives.
Okay, thanks, Natalie. Our next presenter is David Disselhorst from the Bexley Public Library near Columbus.
Yes, just outside Columbus. This picture is from our digital archive, Bexley Responds COVID-19, which we set up on the 20th of March, 2020, as we were closing the library due to the pandemic. This photo was taken on April 16th at Ohio State University's Wexner Medical Center. It was a series of chalk tributes along the parking garage wall for the doctors and nurses and other essential workers to see on their way to work. And We continued developing the archive through July 4th of 2020, and it contains mostly photographs from that 4 month period. And most of them are taken from the Bexley area and some in Columbus.
David, that's really a great project that you guys did. Can we ask a little bit of detail about how you were collecting from the public for this?
So we set up a page on our website where patrons could upload images if they wanted. And unfortunately, we had a tough time gaining interest. I think the archive has maybe 20 images. So I spent most of those 4 months out taking pictures myself. I'm a retired newspaper photographer. So until we reopened the library and I was needed here, I was able to go around the community and take pictures.
Well, thank you for sharing. Next we have, the next slide we have, Nicole Sutton is here from the African American Special Collections collection at the Columbus Metro Library. Tell us more about this picture.
Hello, I'll take off my mask really quickly. Thank you so much for having me. Yes, I am the African American Special Collections Librarian in Local History and Genealogy at the Columbus Metropolitan Library. And this photo actually comes to us through a partnership we have with the King Arts Complex, which is a performing arts organization here in Columbus. And we are working with them to digitize the photo morgue for a Black newspaper called the Columbus Call and Post. And that's where this photograph came from. And unfortunately, for the first decade of the newspaper's existence, there is no remains of it. There are no physical papers, there is no microfilm. All we have are these photographs. So when I heard this year's theme, I was very excited. I started to search our collection using our tags, our subject headings to try to find photographs and then do a little bit of research and find out more about them. So with this one, I was able to find in the Columbus Dispatch, which is the main newspaper here, that there was during the time period that this would have been published in the Call and Post, because we do have dates for them, fortunately. That's one of the few things that we do have for them, is we have dates. There was a week-long campaign going on in Columbus City Schools to provide the rubella vaccination. Of course, in the newspapers, they were calling it the German measles, but we know that as rubella. And they had members of the Academy of Medicine here in Columbus, Columbus Academy of Medicine, going through to help vaccinate children. And we actually had several photos that we voted on as an organization to submit to this, but we really loved this one and loved that it was chosen and voted on by SOA members because, one, they're using new technology. That is an injection gun that they're using. It's fairly new. And it, as you can see, it's kind of intimidating looking. And for a lot of people, getting a shot of any kind is already a very intimidating process. And this little girl, she just looks so brave and she's ready to be there. And also knowing that it was in the Black newspaper. So yes, it was spreading awareness that this vaccination campaign was happening in the schools. But also we have to think about the historical context of the deep mistrust and justified mistrust that a lot of the Black community has had and still does have of the medical industry here, especially in America. And, you know, we can see this brave little girl here getting her vaccination, and we hope that that took a step to helping to repair that relationship and that we're still, again, trying to repair today. So thank you for voting on it, and thank you for having us here today.
Thanks, Nicole. I agree, it's a great photograph. Natalie, you're up to talk about this photograph.
Muted. This picture here is Dr. Thomas W. Burton. He became Springfield's first Black physician. This was despite the fact that he was born a slave in 1860 in Madison County, Kentucky, and he didn't learn to read until he was 21. He went on to attend Berea College in Kentucky, and then the Eclectic Medical College in Indianapolis. He came to Springfield in 1892 and began his medical practice, and married a local woman, Hattie Taylor, in 1893. And after that, he went on to become the first Black owner of a local drugstore. He also owned a shoe store and ran a local newspaper, which, Nicole Worthy, we've not been able to find any evidence of this newspaper still existing, except that we know that he ran one. During the Spanish-American War, he served as a surgeon and was later on the faculty of the Curry Institute, which is county north of us in Urbana and Champaign County, which was a primarily Black trade school that was in Urbana. So he was teaching medicine up there, actually. In 1897, he helped found the Ohio Mutual Medical Association and led an attempt to start a Black hospital locally. Which is an interesting and sad story, the fact that they seemed to have some support, and there was even some a location found and supplies sent there, but there was not enough local support, and the existing hospital was kind of quashed the efforts to start their own hospital. This was in, he started it in retaliation for a policy of the Springfield Hospital refusing to permit Black doctors on staff. And not take part in any part of the hospitals. And they declined to permit Black general practitioners without proper qualifications to attend their patients. The hospital was to be on South Yellow Springs, on the south end of town. And we know that it had been purchased, but we're not sure any more details other than that. I think we got some of this from Dr. Burton's books. He was the author of two books, What Experience Has Taught Me, and an autobiography. And he also wrote A History of the Underground Railroad, American Mysteries and Daughters of Jerusalem, which up until a few years ago, we just knew that these books existed. And when we had done some exhibits and wanted to include information about them, we had borrowed the books from the public library, which is across the tracks from us. And they eventually someone had turned around and donated a copy that they had found. So we have copies of his books now in our own archives that has this great picture of him, but also some pictures of him. There's one of him doing an autopsy and pictures of him with his family and of his house. So we were really happy to finally get those into our collection to be able to share with people. He died in 1939 and is buried here in Springfield in Ferncliff Cemetery. And the few times that I've shared him recently on our Facebook page, I didn't really think about the fact that there might still be people around that were delivered by him. And we had people in the comments saying he delivered me, or he delivered my mother, or whatever. Because, you know, we get into our history is a long time ago. And for him to still be around in 39 and practicing and up and through the 20s and early 30s, we know that he's still serve people that are still around today that remembered him being an active doctor. So, I think that's all I have for that. I think we've got a few more trivia ones after this. This one comes to us from the Athens State Hospital collection that's at Ohio University. Mon Center for Archives and Special Collections. So our question is, the Athens State Hospital, also known as the Athens Lunatic Asylum and Athens Mental Hospital, was later decommissioned and transferred to Ohio University, where today it is known as this. So A, the ledges, B, the edges, C, the ridges, or D, the overlook. And what we have here is a page from a Recreation Department scrapbook in 1953, showing some of the activities of the hospital. We've got one more trivia question for you. This picture here is from a dental clinic from the OSU Health Sciences Library collection. So the question is, how are these dental drills powered? A, by steam, B, horse, D, C, pneumatic, or D, foot? Okay.
Okay. Everybody put down their pencils, right? Okay, here we go. Here are the answers to the trivia questions. The first one was, during which war was that image taken? The answer was C, World War I. Question two, America had three waves of the cholera pandemic, but does anybody know what country the pandemic started? The answer was B, India. Three, the US licensed the polio vaccine for widespread use in B, 1955. Question four, the photo was taken in 1949. What disease do you think the doctors are treating for this child for? The answer was B, polio. Five, the Athens State Hospital, which was then eventually transferred to Ohio University, is now known as C, the Ridges. And finally, how were the dental drills powered? The answer was D, foot. So how did everybody do?
Well, I think we're I hope you guys did good. We went through all of what before we introduce and move on to the next slide. Colette, I don't know if you wanted to share a little bit about what all we're going to be highlighting during Archives Month that people can look forward to.
We have three so far archives that we're going to highlight, and especially their medical collections. And so we'll be putting those on Facebook, and we'll have some cool other photos that they'll be having. And the one that I saw today was from Ohio University, and it was of the ridges. It was layout plan from the 1800s of the ridges. And of course, it was then known as the Ohio Lunatic Asylum, or who knows, it had like eight different names over the course that it was around. But that's the one that's in my mind right now, because I was just looking at it. It's like, that is so cool. If you've ever been to Ohio University, you can swing by the ridges. You can just stop by and take a look around. I wouldn't do it at night because it's haunted. So now that we've all learned about the cool photos, well, Janice has something to say in the...
She's put a link in the chat.
Yeah, she has a link in the chat. But it's time to... I didn't have a hat because I forgot at home, but I have this little thing, and I have all the top 10 winners in here. I'm going to mix it up for the prize, which has been top secret. It's the Bexley Public Library. Your big prize is a gift card to Domino's, so you can have a pizza party. Yay.
Oh. And while we're on that, we want to, Jackie Johnson's on here. When we were brainstorming this, she's the one who came up with that we should have something like this. And she said, you need to give people food for a part or something for a party. So thank you, Jackie, for the idea to try doing this.
Congratulations.
So now that we're all here for the big unveil. So I guess we should have a drum roll. Next slide, please. There you go. I really like this design. I thought they did a great job. Can't really read it right now because it's so small on there. But we have four photos that are featured, and I think they do a great job of showing the variety that you can see in Ohio's healthcare workers. So Ohio's healthcare workers, the true heart of it all. I hope that's corny enough for all of you.
If you guys say, maybe we can read the text for if everybody can't see it. It says, for the past 2 years, healthcare professionals throughout the country have helped us through a pandemic. So healthcare issues are on the minds of many people. From Ohio's first doctor, Samuel P. Hildreth, and his efforts during the great epidemic fever that visited the Ohio Valley in the 1820s, to Albert Sabin, who developed the oral live polio vaccine, Ohioans have made waves in healthcare. Healthcare workers may be like Dr. Thomas Burton of Springfield or like nurses at the Franciscan Sisters of the Poor in Cincinnati, but they all have caring in common. You can follow the history of healthcare in Ohio and archival collections throughout the state. So you guys can look for these. Betsy said that they're due to go out in the mail next week. So when you get them, hang them up in your library, in your archives, share them with people. We'll have Janet's gonna have a blog post about it, and we'll have a downloadable version that people can look at and look at it closer, and you can share it on your Facebook page or tweet it or whatever. But make sure you share it.
I really hope this is you guys have enjoyed this little program. And that it was a way to get everybody interested in all the photos that were submitted, not just the top 10. We appreciate the top 10, but we appreciate all the people who submitted a photo or any sort of image that we had the opportunity to look at, and even display some of the ones in these trivia questions. So I hope you guys are all looking forward to Archives Month. And this is just a little way to get us all excited about it.
And if you, I know that Melissa Dalton's here with the Greene County Archives. I know they have activities planned during Archives Month, some tours and a ghost tour thing that they're doing. So I hope you guys are thinking about things that you can do to highlight your archives during the month and show people what you have and share stuff online. And then we'll be working on a new theme with the committee next year, and we'll be putting out a call for next year's theme starting in early March, and we usually collect through the end of April. So stay tuned to see what next year's theme is. If you have any ideas, you can send them our way, and we can add them to our list of ones to discuss. And then we'll hope to get lots of submissions, and then we can do this again next year.